Let's welcome our other panelists to the stage for a discussion on SMRs as disruptive technology. I'll introduce Kirk Anderson and Ken Canavan. Please come up. Kirk Atkinson is an expert on small modular reactors in the marine context. He served on the Physics Working Group and Science Support Network for the UK Naval Nuclear Propulsion Program and was part of the team assessing nuclear power options for future Royal Navy submarines. A visiting lecturer at the University of Manchester, where he taught on the UK's NTEC MSc program. He joined the Faculty of Energy Systems and Nuclear Science at Ontario Tech University as an associate professor in January of last year. As naval reactors are the original SMRs, he is perhaps the only Canadian academic with real-world experience working in a successful program encompassing the design, manufacture, operation, and disposal of small pressurized water reactors. Ken Canavan joined Westinghouse as the Chief Technology Officer in January of 2018. He leads the Global Technology Organization and is responsible for ensuring that the Westinghouse technology vision and business strategy are aligned. Ken brings 34 years of nuclear experience to the position, half utility plant experience and half research and development experience. He most recently served as Director of Engineering for the Electric Power Research Institute. While there, he turned industry needs into compelling research and development plans. These plans resulted in solutions to improve the safety and performance of the global nuclear fleet. So welcome to our panel. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
And so we're talking about disruptive technology, and I think we want to look at that as a positive thing, meaning applications and changes that weren't foreseen but have big implications. And I want to use an analogy of the steam engine, that for the first few decades, it was just a way to pump water out of a coal mine. It didn't change most people's lives. But when steam engines got smaller, safer, and more efficient, they suddenly moved on to mobile platforms like boats and locomotives. And they changed the entire world with steamships and railways. So can SMRs do something similar? What do you think?
Well, I think that actually they already did. So coming from the submarine program in the UK, pulling our friends in the US, for the last 60 to 70 years, small, now modular reactor plants have been used in naval propulsion. In the early days of propulsion, there was a lot of interest from the world in whether you could use nuclear power for container shipping, for moving goods around, and it kind of went away. You know, it various aspects of fuel prices and non-proliferation and then accidents that came in later years have taken away that possibility. But if you wanted to consider the amount of impact shipping has on carbon emissions, it has something like, if you were to equate it to a country, you know, it might be the seventh biggest country in the world in terms of CO2 emissions. That kind of amount. It is huge. Yeah. In this interconnected world where we have factories in China sending goods to North America and goods from and farming stuff and agriculture products going back in the other direction, we want to move those goods around faster. We want to move them more economically. But if you wanted to speed up a ship by, say, a couple of knots, your CO2 goes up by something like 13%, might be 15%, depends on the exact ship design that you've got. So we've kind of already been there, but I think this would have a huge impact in terms of climate change. And the technology is already there. You know, as you said in the bio, you know, defense programs in the UK and in the US and in France, talking about the Western nations, have already demonstrated that nuclear propulsion is a very viable technology, but obviously it works under the security of an individual nation. If you look to Russia, they've taken one of their derived from their defense program. They've taken one of their plants, put it on a barge, and there you go. You've got an SMR, and it's there already. So
okay, Ken.
I'm a firm believer that. Let me start off by saying when I joined Westinghouse in 2018, the advanced reactor folks that worked in the innovation department said, "Glad you're here. Let's sit down and have a conversation about our latest technology." Da Vinci sat down and the first slide, I flipped open to the first slide, and it said, "Welcome to the disruption of the electric industry." Because if you look at very small reactors, if they're put into the commercial environment, they're actually distributed generation. So if you look at it, you distribute them. First thing I said was, well, let's remove all those slides about disruption, because nuclear power doesn't like disruption at the time, right? When you're seeking innovation dollars and you want to move things forward, you don't necessarily want to start off with the conversation about being disruptive. I went this morning and looked up that conversation. I pulled up those slides from early 2018, and they're right on track. If you look at this and play this forward, and you look at a distributed type reactor that's passive and inherently safe, that's 2 to 10 megawatts, that's transportable, based in heat pipe technology, can't melt, doesn't leak. You start looking at that and you think, let me put that in a remote location, because right now they're having trouble getting diesel. It's very difficult for us to transport all the necessary maintenance and parts and fuel. So if I could locate this, if I could transport this reactor and locate it, I lose that logistics train. And that logistics train is important, because you got to remember from the perspective of the people who live in that community, very often they find themselves in a situation where, for example, they're not washing clothes because the diesel barge hasn't shown up yet. You have to make choices. And so it's disruptive in that those choices now go away. A matter of fact, you might cook with oil or gas, and you might decide, why would I do that? Sometimes I run out of gas and I have to wait, but if I had an electric stove and I had a small modular, very small micro reactor, I wouldn't have to wait. And I find it interesting that if you play this forward a number of years, and I think we're going to talk a little bit about that, but if you play this forward a few years, maybe not a few, maybe a decade or two, I do believe that it can be very disruptive. If we have a nuclear battery, if that's the concept, right? If the concept is a nuclear battery, batteries can go lots of places. They can do lots of things. They enabled a lot of things. You can't have a cell phone without a battery, right? You can't have a flashlight without a battery. You can't have so many things, if you think about it, without a battery. So it certainly can be very disruptive and change the way we think about life, I think.
Right. Mark, do you think SMRs can change the world?
Oh. We talk about all the things that it can do, but I think the most important thing, if you actually have some SMRs. That's why I'm such a pusher on getting a prototype. If you have something that is operating, that doesn't leak, is very simple, that is not scary at all, that is going to change the world, because many people can come and see it and look at it. I mean, I guess maybe a horrible analogy, but that's why we originally had zoos, so people could see things that they wouldn't see from other places. If we had something that people could go up to, see it, touch it, they realize that they're not being affected by it, but yet I have all this amazing energy. I think that the whole aura around nuclear would change drastically, which then you can start to get that snowball rolling in the right direction. Because right now, let's face it, you're gonna go, oh, that nuclear plant, it has that big tower that's spewing out all that radiation. I know. And you can't get to it, by the way, there's a big fence. And there's lots of guys with big arm guards. And holy crap, and that must be like really, there people must be dying in there. I think they're dying in there. So we get ourselves a VSMR and people are coming up to it and they can give it a little hug. I think we might get to the right place.
Hug your SMR, yeah. Ken, I want to come back to something. you said about the size and scope of them and batteries and, mm-hmm. you know, how small can they actually get, do you think?
Very small. So a lot of these reactors, including the Avinci, which is a heat pipe reactor, have their genesis in space reactors, which are very small. They're on the kilopower side. So they can get very, very small. And you know, from my perspective, that's actually one of the very interesting things about it. We do lose economies of scale. As you get smaller, things do get, they do get more expensive. There is a reason why we make big reactors. But technology is advancing, which helps us lower costs and prices. And I'll also point out, I know we like to think it's always all about price, and in the beginning it might be. But how many people have a cell phone, a smartphone, right? Everybody, right? How many people have two? How many people have a teenage son or daughter with a $1,000 phone in their pocket? I have two. If you had told me 20 years ago that I would put a $1,000 cell phone in my future child's pocket, because they weren't around yet, I would tell you you were crazy. And now I have two of them. So the moral of the story is, when if the benefit is high enough, the costs become less less important. And so I would even challenge you, what's the kilowatt hour rating of a AA battery? And it's really bad. But you buy them anyway because they're necessary, because they power the TV remote and you're not going to get up and change the TV channel anymore. Now, those of you who laughed, I know how old you are. But the moral of the story is they change technology, they change the way we view the world, they change what we do. And I believe that we will start in a very large size of micro reactor, we'll call it a 2 megawatt to 10 megawatt. But eventually there'll be niches that want something different, a variant, something smaller. And then, just like solar panels, right? We put solar panels, where'd they go first? They went into the Arctic because they were expensive and you couldn't run an extension cord. They went into places you couldn't reach. Where are micro reactors gonna go? They're gonna go in places where we can't reach. Places where it's hard to ship things. But what happened to solar panels after that? Well, they started becoming something that somebody would put on their roof as they got used to them, as they got comfortable with them. Some people started putting them on their roofs. Now, everybody's putting them on their roofs, and it's very disruptive. So if you start looking at a micro reactor and start thinking about, well, if we go out 20, 30 years, would these start appearing in New York City under One Police Plaza? Because in Superstorm Sandy, they want One Police Plaza to not run out of power. They want to not be dependent upon a grid. So my question to the audience here is, if you play it out 20, 30 years, are we taking apart the grid that we put together over the last 150 years? Because we have a new technology that really has changed the way we perceive power.
That's a good thought. Kirk, what do you think about that?
I tend to agree. The idea of being able to produce sub-megawatt quantities of electricity, I think, is certainly achievable. Places like hospitals, when you want your critical care to be maintained if there was a power outage. But obviously, we can't get around the laws of physics either. So if we're going to be reliant on fission, we're going to be making radiation, and we're going to need sufficient materials to do moderation if it's a thermal reactor. So there will be a absolute smallest size that we can hit. Now, what that number is, I don't have offhand. But the idea of there being distributed power in your emergency services, in your healthcare, in the shopping mall, even, you know, I don't see why that couldn't be realizable.
We've thought of SMRs in a certain context mostly, but there are many other applications for them. Obviously, things like seawater desalination, producing hydrogen as an energy carrier. So, Mark, what are some of the applications we aren't thinking about?
I think we maybe will get to it because we were talking a little bit about it, and that's from an aviation or a transport standpoint, right? Right now, we're obviously burning a lot of jet fuel out there. We're doing a lot of, you know, adding more pollution. And we really haven't thought yet about what other applications beyond the mass transport, the trucking, that sort of thing. But it's starting to happen now. As I understand, I think it was in December of just this last year, they did an electric airplane, a commuter out in Vancouver. And very limited distance, obviously, because of battery limitations. But someday, with fuel cells and adding the distance to that, we're going to see a totally different way for us to actually be moving people around from an air perspective as well. So I think that's some pretty exciting stuff, I think, because we can see the contrails up there all the time and thinking, yeah, we're spewing out quite a bit, and we all do a lot of travel to keep the economy going. So I think that's a big disruption that'll occur.
Kirk, other thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, the transportation, I've already said when I came in and gave my first statement, say maybe 10 years ago, we did a little piece of work from my old department, and it was looking at cruise liners. And, you know, I didn't know this, but I've never been on a cruise. The oil price was quite high. In fact, Congress, for their defense side, actually mandated that they should make nuclear ships because it's cheaper than using, you know, oil. But we found out that a passenger being 1 hour late back to the ship for the cruise, if you're in the Caribbean and then you've got to get back to, what is it, Fort Lauderdale or wherever it is that these ships go from, that 1 hour to catch up costs $50,000 in extra fuel, US. Yeah? Just because that person was 1 hour late because they were in the gift store getting a little bit extra. Now, you know, so we did a bit of work on this, and it was looking promising. We had actual interest from cruise line companies. Now then the oil price changed and everything else. But this idea of mass transportation using nuclear power, I come back to the point of fuel cells. I did a little bit of looking at this a while ago. And the idea of using fuel cells for ferries is there. People are using them in some places. But they've got really limited duration. You know, their range is very small, which isn't something that we would have with nuclear power. Yeah, nuclear power, it's there. You know, we can go from one side of the world to the other, you know, much more quickly. Now, some years ago as well, there was an idea about having a mothership almost. I sound like space now. You know, my name is Kirk, of course, and so those who are old enough, they can figure that out. But there was an idea that this mothership could actually make hydrogen for a bunch of smaller ships to go and actually take goods into smaller territories. Therefore, you get around the issue of regulation about having to go into ports in some of these countries which don't want nuclear shipping going into their ports. So I think this is definitely an area where things could change.
Ken, can you think of other areas where SMRs could drive down the cost of things?
Yes. So, I mean, if I go back to the analogy of once we make a battery, when batteries first came out, they had a specific use, right? It was really to light lanterns so we didn't have to carry around fire. But, you know, batteries slowly but surely made its way into everything, right? And I think it's the same sort of concept with an SMR. Once you make it of a certain size, people will figure out how to use it. And I don't know that right now we can sit around and you know, think about or even come up with all the concepts that would be in 30 years used. But if you think about high temperature process heat, the picture of oil sands was up just a little while ago, and process heat would be very useful there, I'm sure, at lowering the carbon footprint. And if we start thinking about district heating and desalination, and there's a number of things that we can think of. And as I look at DaVinci, right, every time I go to sleep, I keep thinking, it's a battery, right? And where are all my Ryobi or DeWalt attachments to my battery? What are all the tools I can put on it? Process heat, desalination, all kinds of other uses, some of which we haven't even thought of yet, that will come our way. So I do think that it's an enabler, right? That's part of what disruptive technology is. The reason why it's disruptive is it enables other things.
If I may add, I gave the, you know, maybe not the perfect example with creating hydrogen and fuel cells using SMRs and nuclear, but another one that I was at an SMR conference down in Atlanta a number of years ago, and it was another laboratory, and I was racking my brains trying to remember which lab. It was from Europe. But they had a mission that their government had asked them to do, and that was create a small enough SMR that would be truck-based, and that they could be, you know, put on some sea cargo containers, and then whenever there was a humanitarian need, when there was a hurricane, when there was a tsunami, and the power's knocked out, to be able to actually transport that and put it there. And I think that is a brilliant approach, because as we all know, during those events, it's power. How do you get back up on your feet again, you know? And
yeah,
Puerto Rico would have loved to have a few of those, I think. So, yeah, I think that that's a huge benefit that we could have from a very small reactor. Right.
Mark, you alluded to this in your comments earlier, but how quickly do we need to move on this? Because there is a window, right?
Yeah, we keep saying we got to do it within a year or two. You know, we're starting to sound like fusion. It's going to happen. Got to have it. And, you know, it's got to be in the next 10 years. Got to be in the next 10 years. So, I know I don't want to be overly optimistic. I don't want us to put goals out there that are unrealistic, and then we fail, and everybody points to us and says, "There you go again. You know, you made all the promises, and you weren't able to deliver on them." But I'm not kidding. I think everyone agrees. I would think. You know, we have, in other countries, not the Western world, we have SMRs on barges being moved right now, right? There is movement that's happening out there. There's a certain amount of time that the market is open. I mean, given that we just have to do it as fast as we can because of the climate, just got to do it just for that reason. But if you look at it from the perspective that Canada wants to be a world leader, the Team Canada has got to get this going. The window is starting to close rapidly if we don't get going. So the timelines I talked about up there on the three streams, I think we need to stick to those, that we have to get somewhere in the mid-late 20s here, that we get a prototype that people can come and see, a physical thing that they can actually touch and see and start to play with. So that's, I think we're really at that point.
Yeah, I 100% agree. I think we need to get the thing out that people can look and see and touch. The beauty of microreactors, all of the different designs of microreactors, is they are smaller, they are simpler, they are quicker to build, they're factory built. I'm not saying there's not challenges, because I'm not that guy. As a matter of fact, I'm the guy who has to deal with all those challenges. But I do think there are all things we can overcome, things that we can resolve. And I see the mid-2020s, a matter of fact, a lot of the microreactor vendors have timeframes in the 2020s to have something that's actually nuclear fueled and demonstrating. 2025, for example, is a Vinci. 2021 is an electrical demonstration unit where all the principles will be shown except for the reactor core and physics. Again, there's a window, and we do need to walk through it.
Where are the challenges and obstacles going to be, though? And is it in terms of public acceptance? Is it government? Is it on the business side?
Yes.
Yeah, you got it. You should talk about this. Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. I mean, it is about government. It was great to hear from Minister Reagan to give that signal. Hugely important. That then sends a signal into the investors out there. But then there needs to be some matching fund from government, and that's why, you know, everyone light their candles, say their prayers up to the announcement on funding here in the budget in March. That's incredibly important. And then the other huge one is going to be the public acceptance, and that we have to work all of those in parallel. But public acceptance is up to us to get out there and talk to your neighbors. You know,
yep.
You know, I had this kind of crazy idea when you manage a site. You know, one of the things that you're, or any business, is to, you have to carve out, get away from your computer and get away from your meetings once in a while, and carve out time to go and talk on the floor, see what's happening. So you really know what the heck you're talking about, right? I almost think we have to do another carve out here, that all of us in here have to spend some time where you go and you talk to, pick a community. No, I love you guys, because you like nuclear, but go not to a CNA conference, but to another conference that doesn't know about what we're doing in nuclear, or go to the Chamber of Commerce, or go to the schools or whatever. But we need to start to get that pull happening and that better understanding. So that's the third huge piece, I think, that we can all do a little bit on.
Yeah. How many students we have? Okay, just remember.
I need sunglasses.
Life-changing career, right? You're saving the lives of your fellow humans on the planet, right?
That's a fact.
I mean, when my kids were really young, they used to say, "Daddy, what do you do?" And I said, "Well, I'm making the world safe for nuclear power, and getting it used and useful and keeping it safe for the benefit of the population." I mean, putting the things out that we put into the air by burning fossil fuels is really not a good idea. No matter what you believe about warming or not warming, it's just a bad idea. We all have to breathe the air, and it doesn't come out. You put it in, it doesn't come out.
Right.
The conversation needs to be about, why would you do that when you have a perfectly fine nuclear option? Why would you do that? And the reason why I picked on the students is, it's the next generation that's going to do a lot of this, that's
right. going
to shape a lot of this. And in my opinion, if you take a career in nuclear, you're taking a career that improves the planet, and you should be proud of that. And if I go to one more cocktail party and my wife has to tell me to stop talking about it, I think I'll have a different problem.
Kirk, can you share your thoughts on timelines and obstacles?
Yeah, I mean, I completely concur with their timelines in terms of when we could build and have in service an SMR. I think there are challenges. You know, we know that the workforce is definitely one of those challenges. We know that there's a shortage of the right kind of people with the right kind of skill sets. So at schools like Ontario Tech, we are able to teach younger people, students, about SMR technologies, and we're doing it now. We're not waiting. Even this last week, we formed up our own center for small modular reactors at the university to try and push forward some of this activity, just by being more aligned and more coherent. But it's not just us. We've all got to work on this. It's not just our school or one of the other schools here in Canada or the companies or the national labs. Yeah, we've all got to work together, otherwise we're not going to win.
Okay, we're going to open it up to you for some questions on SMRs as disruptive technology. If you have a question, please put up your hand right now. We have one in the front here. If somebody else has a question, put up your hand now and we'll get a second microphone to you so we can do them as quickly as possible. So here we go over in that area, and there's a person with his hand up here. Go ahead.
Part of the challenge, I think, is that we have a wide spectrum from micro to small, and we haven't really focused on one to actually go for it. My question is, shouldn't we be focusing on one and then start from that and then migrate either down or up? And the next question is, and I know you can't talk about it, why are we calling it disruptive and it's been on board frigate ships for 70 years? So that's it.
Who wants to tackle that?
Which one?
Ken?
You go ahead.
Two really good questions. So the first question is, shouldn't we be narrowing down our focus? So I unfortunately was on another SMR panel not that long ago, and there were 13 SMR vendors on the dais, and they apologized that they couldn't fit everybody, that there were actually more. And one of my first comments in that was, we really should be looking to the left and to the right and figuring out how we're all going to partner up, because there aren't going to be 13 reactors. I think the free market and our competitive nature has resulted in a lot of concepts, and we're actually very close to the process of down-selecting now. I think you see that with governments looking at down-selecting both in Canada, the US, and other places. So I think we're in the middle of that down-selection process, and it's an important process where at the end we need to come out with the two or three that we're gonna collectively as an industry get behind and push. So I think the answer to that is we're at that precipice. Funding's about to come out, and it won't be for everybody. And then we'll have to figure out how we take partner up and take the best pieces of each concept and make sure that we're on the right technical track for what we're going to do. In other words, partner up. And as for, we've been doing this a long time. I asked that question the other day to somebody else and said, we've been doing this a long time, so what's different? I think what's different is we're in a different place. I think carbon's become important. I think we're starting to realize it's a small planet and we're influencing it dramatically in numbers of ways, and we need to stop doing that. And nuclear energy is the only energy that keeps all its waste in one place, which we take a lot of grief for, but believe it or not, that's important. It's the reason why it's different. Everybody else puts their waste and distributes it, and the solution to pollution is not dilution.
Very good. I agree with Ken. I think we are getting to that point where we have to narrow it down. You know, in the early days, it was great to just kind of let it, a little free flow, let it go and see what starts to emerge. And it's a complicated formula because there's actually a number of viable designs out there, but where are they really in their design? Where are they really? And this is some of the things that we've been looking at from our site selection process with the different applicants. Where are you really in your design? And what are the things that we can help you with to move forward with it? And we realize that there won't be money for all of them. And we're a host, you know, we can host a number, but the reality will be that you just cannot do many of them. We said that early on just to not have that as a boundary that you had to look at. It was artificial. But as we move forward, the amount of money that will be available will be limited. But it won't be one. It will have to be, as we said, in the different streams, there'll be multiple designs for different applications out there as well.
All right, next question.
Thank you. Is it working? First of all, thank you all for a great presentation. Actually, the question I was going to ask was the question that was just asked, but I'm going to ask a question from Mark, my friend here. Hello,
Ash.
Mark.
Hello, Ash.
So what are you guys, you said you're not building reactors at CNL, and yeah. What are you doing at CNL toward development and deployment of SMRs? That's one question.
Okay.
The other question, in America, we call SMRs the light water SMRs. The other ones that are not light water, we call it advanced reactor and micro. Do you distinguish that here too, like that? Or when you say SMR, are we talking about everything or are you talking about water cooled SMRs?
So I guess I'll take the second question first, and you guys might be able to help me better on that one, actually. We're looking at some of there's a combination when we talk about SMRs here, I'll be honest. We have different applications that are different. So those that are applying to us for sites right now, for a site potentially right now, are a combination. Some are light water reactor or moving forward, some are gas reactors, some are salt reactors. So it's a combination, it's not just one. What is CNL doing? Easier question. So it's a nice setup. I've talked about it a little bit. We're really a host now, so we don't, the design portion of LVACL was sold off before CNL was created, and sometimes there is confusion as to, so what's the CNL small modular reactor design? You know, no. We're a host. So think of it as a park where you would have entrepreneurs come and set up their business, except we're a little more high tech. We have some folks, you know, 500 PhD masters that are really excited from A to Z. What could we do to help make this become a reality, answer the technical questions? That's like the pinnacle. But we also have security services, waste services, health physics. We have a site, we have property, we have fences. We have, you know, whatever you need to set up a site so you can focus on your design, and we can help with the rest of that. So that's really where CNL steps in from a VSMR and citing one. But then again, it's the research side of any of the designs that are out there right now. And as I said earlier, we're working each stream. Thanks, Ash.
Okay. Other questions? We have one right here. And there's one over there, I think. Yep. We'll get a microphone over to you, Bob.
Hi, good morning. I was really inspired by the comment that not only must the industry want to produce it, but people must want it. So I'm thinking globally now. The United Nations, they've pointed that there are 1.1 billion people that still live in the world without power. So what drives me as a human being is the reduction in povertization in the world. I think it's these big things that drive us. So in terms of want and need, it really is there. But I think we have to, yes, the prototype is a good starting point, but I think there's a bigger potential to unlock, a global potential. So my question to the panel is, we know the political importance of this. Is there something we could do through the government of Canada to sort of work through the United Nations to sort of move the initiative bigger than we are? Because I think those are the things that will make it sustainable in the long run. Thanks.
Anyone?
Well, I 100% agree. I don't know that I can answer your question about lobbying the government of Canada to do something, but I can absolutely agree that when we look at eVinci and we look at very small modular reactors, for example, those are ways to provide electricity to remote locations, and most of the places that you speak of lack a grid, lack a remote location, and are remote locations. So they would be easily served by something like that. So I do agree that it's a solution. We need some time to develop that solution, make sure it's commercial, and get it deployed, but I think that that's a natural extension of that. People will start seeing it, for example, as another use. Let's electrify the world. So again, it's a disruptive technology that I think disrupts in a good way. It gives us a way to provide electricity to an area that doesn't have a grid. I mean, that's one of the powers, and that's one of those disruptions.
So the people in those poorer nations, which could really do with, you know, stable electricity supplies to improve their economic position and their way of life, they're not traditional, I would say, STEM countries. Yeah. So I think the more developed nations would have a responsibility to ensure that the people were sufficiently educated to understand the technologies that's coming their way.
If I could add,
that's a good point.
Go ahead, Ken.
No, I was just agreeing.
Agreed, yeah. Great points. I agree. This is what really I think drives so many of us, is that, you know, there is this energy poverty. We can help, and we can do it in a way that's climate conscious, right? We have to do that. But there is a couple of big things that Canada can do and is doing. And first off is to call nuclear clean energy. It's clean energy. You know, you realize we're still not really rated out there, like the World Bank, as clean energy. So loans, money to get into the system to help make this happen, isn't. You know, you hear, was it Morgan, one of the bankers, you know, they said, we're out of coal, we're going to do $200 billion and support clean energy and invest. Great, but we're not on that list. So that's huge. Canada can help, other countries can help and say, it's clean, look at it. So that's an important one, I think, that we could do.
All right, let's squeeze in two more quick questions, starting right here, and then I know we have a question over here, if we can get a microphone over there. Go ahead.
Good morning, Mark. You're over here, Adrian Foster, Municipality of Clarendon. Mark, thank you for your comments about the requirement that we get out and tell the story to chambers of commerce. We've had dialogue. I'm sitting with Sue, one of your favorite mayors as well. We've been talking about this for a year and a half, 2 years now. Yeah. We're in a room full of stakeholders that we've spoken to as well. How do we take steps forward? Because it is an amazing story, but there is a huge amount of education that needs to be done in schools, as well as with a lot of elected officials. So I might be thanking you for giving me a soapbox and throwing down a gauntlet at the same time.
Yeah, you know, and CNA can help a lot with that, quite frankly. They have a plethora of information that is really well packaged, that's available online that they can get. So when they take that, when they want to go and have a discussion about clean energy, have a debate, we have great information that can answer a heck of a lot of questions for anybody. So you don't have to be the expert, but you can pick that up, do a little bit of studying, and you can really get the messages out there if you feel so moved. So I'd recommend that, and recommend that to anyone else that gets interested that you may be talking to.
Okay, Bob?
Look, wonderful panel. Thank you enormously for this. If I come away from this last day and a half, I think you've got one of the key takeaways. SMRs is a disruptive technology. I think it's time for our industry to really embrace that and understand what a disruptive technology actually means. Mm-hmm. What has automation meant to manufacturing? What has it changed? Everything. The question is, are we as an industry ready to be disrupted? My sense is that we're tinkering on the edges of what it means to us. Are we really thinking about new business models that don't have utilities as owner-operators? are we really thinking about NIMBY being nuclear is in my backyard? Everything changes. And so I think you've left us with the key takeaway. We have to embrace the change that disruptive technology will mean to us. Comments?
I agree. I think that's a great comment, Bob. You're right. We don't have as much. We've been pretty steady state here for quite a while, right? And we kind of stuck our head in the sand a bit to stay out of the limelight a bit long. And we're probably not the pros at understanding what it takes to really embrace a disruptive technology. That's a real good point. I had not thought of that before.
I'll amplify your point a little bit and just say, okay, so utility industry has been around for 150 years. We make electricity, and the total thought process was build a big plant, put it on the grid, operate that plant with all my other plants up and down to control the grid, and that's been the plan. So disruption's happening to us, because that's not the plan anymore. The plan anymore is rooftop solar and wind and integration and a fast-acting grid to quickly change load because a cloud passed by, right? That's where we are now. And then the future disruptions are build small generation that fits into that mix to support that new dynamic. And now comes along even a smaller one that allows high power generation but operates like wind and solar in the fact that it can be distributed. So I think the short answer is disruption has been happening to us for a little while. We're about to happen to it, right? We're about to take control of that. Because if we put out very small modular reactors, we have to figure out how they're going to work in the bigger grid and what they're going to enable. And so I think we spent 150 years building a grid, and we're going to spend about 30 taking it apart and figuring out what the hybrid looks like, right? Because we still need transmission, we still need distribution, but it'll be different.
Yeah, I agree with that.
All right. Kirk, Ken, Mark, thank you so much. Great discussion.
Appreciate it.